Welcome back to RU Connected Learning. In this video, we'll describe what a bond is, familiarize ourselves with terminology specific to bonds, understand how to value a bond, and discuss several types of bonds. There are two ways for companies to raise money, through debt or through equity. And to raise money through either, companies can issue what is called a security. A bond is a debt security. It allows companies to borrow a certain amount of money from members of the public and repay them according to some specified terms. Since bonds are issued in batches, each batch usually has standardized terms. On the other hand, shares are equity securities. We'll talk more about them in the next video. For now, let's focus on bonds. Bonds have a lot of associated jargon, but at the end of the day, they're just another kind of loan. So a useful way to decipher the language of bonds is to associate it with roughly equivalent terms that we're already familiar with. Every loan has a principal amount, or the amount that was actually borrowed and must be repaid when the loan matures. The face value of a bond is like the principal of a loan. However, for bonds, it's generally always $1,000, and unless a problem we're solving says otherwise, we stick with that assumption. Where loans might have regular cash flows, bonds have coupon payments, which are essentially the same thing. However, unlike with regular loans, we usually won't be given an outright monetary amount for the coupon payment. We'll be given a coupon rate instead, which we need to multiply by the face value to give us the payment amount. This extra step exists because of the way information is recorded on the bond certificate. For example, a 5% coupon rate with a face value of 1,000 means our coupon payment, or C value, is 1,000 times 0.05, or $50. Bonds also have an interest rate, or required rate of return, which is not to be confused with the coupon rate. The coupon rate is one of those standardized terms that are attached to the bond and it stays constant, but the interest rate is determined by the market and can fluctuate over time. This can alter the value of the remaining cash flows of the bond, so it's a critical determinant of the bond's value. With respect to bonds, the rate is called the yield to maturity, which we'll abbreviate to YTM. Finally, bonds have a specified length of time or number of periods for which they last. In bond jargon, that's called the time to maturity. The final day of the life of the bond is called the maturity date, on which the issuer of the bond has to pay back the bondholder the principal and interest amounts. While we're on the topic, it's worth mentioning that the majority of bonds make payments semi-annually, and if we're not given any information to the contrary, that's the assumption we stick with. This would affect our number of periods, our yield to maturity, and our coupon rate. If the payments are semi-annual, our number of periods is essentially double the years to maturity. The yield to maturity and the coupon rate, on the other hand, would be halved. The value of a bond can be broken down into two components. A portion of the bond's value comes from the present value of its face value. Another portion of its value comes from the present value of the coupon payments. When we add the two of these together, we get the total value of the bond. The present value of its face value, which is one cash flow of what is usually $1,000, is given to us by the present value formula we used for the single cash flow. In other words, all we do is multiply the face value by the present value interest factor at rate R and periods N. Our R value would be our YTM, adjusted for how often the bond makes a coupon payment. Our N value would be our time to maturity, assuming it's given to us in years, multiplied by the number of payments per year. The second component, the present value of the coupon payments, can be found using the present value formula for annuities, as coupon payments are regular payments of some fixed amount made until some fixed date, essentially like an annuity. Here, C is the coupon payment multiplied by the present value interest factor of annuities, or PVIFA, at rate R and periods N, adjusted for the amount of payments in a year. Now let's try to put that formula into use, as well as illustrate the relationship between YTM and the value of the bond. A bond with a 5% semi-annual coupon matures in 20 years and has a yield to maturity of 8%. What is the value of the bond today? The total value of a bond is the sum of the present value of its face value and the present value of its coupons. And the present value of its face value is given by face value times the present value interest factor. And the present value of the coupons is given by the coupon payment times the present value interest factor of annuities. And expanding these out further, the present value interest factor is equal to 1 over 1 plus r raised to n. And the present value interest factor of annuities is equal to 1 minus 1 over 1 plus r raised to n divided by r. But before we can move on, we need to remember that this is a semi-annual coupon bond, and so our R, our N, and C values would be affected by this. R is, or our yield to maturity, is given to us as 8%. We would have to divide that by 2 for use in this question, so that would be 0.04. Our N value is given to us as 20 years to maturity, and since there are 2 payments in a year, that leaves us with 40 payments till maturity. And our C value is given to us as 5% of our face value. So 1,000 times 0.05 should be 50, and divided by 2 should give us a coupon payment of 25. Plugging those values into our formula, we should get 1,000 times 1 over 1.04 raised to 40 plus 25 times 1 minus 1 over 1.04 raised to 40 divided by 0.04. And when we add these all up, we should get $703.11 as the price for our coupon bond. The reason it's selling for less than the face value is because we have to remember that the yield to maturity represents the required rate of return. So other bonds on the market with similar features are giving off an 8% coupon payment, whereas ours is giving off a 5% payment. So it makes sense that ours would be worth less. And when it's the case that the price of the bond is less than the face value, we can say that it's a discount bond, or that it's selling for a discount. And usually it'll be a discount bond if the coupon payment or the coupon rate is less than the yield to maturity. So since in this case our coupon rate was 0.05 and our yield to maturity is 0.08, we know that it is a discount bond. And we can just intuitively, theoretically kind of grasp that. But if the yield to maturity is equal to the coupon rate, we will find the price of the bond is exactly $1,000. This makes sense because our bond is paying just as much as other similar bonds, and therefore it sells at face value. When this is the case, we can say that the bond is selling at par, or that it is a par bond. If the yield to maturity is less than the coupon rate, the price of the bond will be higher than the face value. That's because it's paying more than similar bonds. And we can say that it's selling at a premium, or that it's a premium bond. There are several kinds of bonds. We'll talk about 3 which are immediately important. The first and most widespread is called a regular bond, which resembles an interest-only loan. You should recall this from the previous couple of videos in this series. This is the kind of bond we've been focusing on for the length of the video, and so the formula for calculating its total value would be the same as the one we've been using, the sum of the present value of the face value and the present value of the coupon payments. The second is a zero-coupon bond, which resembles a pure discount loan. That should also be something that rings a bell from the previous videos. We still use the same formula, however, since the coupon payment is zero, we can completely ignore the second half of the equation. The value of the bond is equal to just the present value of the face value. The third is a perpetual bond, and from its name you'd be right in thinking that it behaves like a perpetuity. In other words, it just makes coupon payments forever. It can also be valued using the same basic formula, but opposite to the zero coupon bond, it derives its worth solely from the present value of the coupon payments, so we can completely ignore the first half of the equation to obtain the total value of perpetual bonds. That brings us to the end of the video. Still confused? Rewind to the relevant part of the video by clicking on the sections listed to the left. For more, be sure to take a look at the tip sheets uploaded to the Academic Success Center website by following the link in the description. Need a more face-to-face approach? Check out tutoring hours at the Ryerson University Academic Success Center's website. And if you've been watching this series from the first video onwards, I just want to say I feel like we've really started to bond.